Well, somebody requested a song, and this is a song I don't really know, but that's never stopped me before, so. Such a people pleaser. Oh, that's the right key. History, a light so many strain to see, the one we talk so much about, but rarely ever live it out. Could you tell me why? Was it for this you came and died? A once a week observance when we coldly mouth your words. Lord, I long to see your presence in reality, but I don't know how. Let me know you in the now. We should confess, we lose you in our busyness. We've made you in our image, so our faith's idolatry. Lord, forgive me and break my heart so I can see all the ways you dwell in us, that you're alive in me. Lord, I long to see your presence in reality, but I don't know how. Let me know you in the now. Thank you. Wow. That music, that's a young man's game. Music is. You're welcome. Okay. So, yeah. Okay. Let's talk some more about Jesus' world. And again, just to make this clear, you know, I said at the very first, you know, there's a difference between knowing about Jesus and knowing Jesus. And, you know, when I was a little kid and walked the aisle, I knew Jesus. Well, he knew me. I invited him into my heart. Well, he invited me into his heart. And, you know, I was saved, and I had a relationship with him, and it was real. And but that's when you begin wanting to know more about him, and that's where I've been ever since, is wanting to know everything there is to know about him. So let's talk a little bit about just his world. One of the biggest mistakes we've made in biblical studies is we take post 70 AD Judaism. You know what's happened in 70? That's when the Romans destroyed the temple. Okay, so everything changed after 70 AD. So what we do is we take post 70 AD Judaism and we superimpose it on Jesus' world. And so many misunderstandings come from that. And this is not complicated. I'll explain. This is not a complex idea. In Jesus' world, we have Israelite religion, right? The religion that we get from the Old Testament, priests, temples, sacrifices, that sort of thing. But we also have the beginning of what will come to be known as Rabbinic Judaism. But what is so important, this may be the most important thing to realize, in Jesus' day, that world is just beginning. There is no such thing as an ordained rabbi in Jesus' day. That's post-70 AD Judaism. Now, we have rabbis who are famous teachers. We have Hillel. We have Shammai. We have the beginning of rabbinic schools. But no such thing as an ordained rabbi in Jesus' day. That's not until later. So Jesus is in this very fragmented world. Israelite religion, rabbis, Sadducees, Essenes, Zealots, this fragmented world. And no one agrees on anything. They don't agree on Scripture, the text of Scripture. They don't agree on resurrection. They don't agree on angels. About the only thing they agree on is the Sabbath. And so that's Jesus' world. And very, very important to understand Judaism's. And rabbi does not, in Jesus' day, doesn't mean what it means now. The word rabbi comes from the Hebrew word rav, which means great. It's just kind of an honorific title, great one, or there's a bird. Yeah. So my dyslexia, that's going to distract me. Poor thing. Go reach up there and grab it. It's not going to bite you. Okay. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. There we go. Okay. Has anybody got a BB gun? I'm just kidding. Come on. Look at that. Up. Oh, we just leave it alone. It's fine. It's fine. I heard there was a guy doing a presentation in Israel one time. The guides tell this story all the time. And he did like this and made a point, and a bird landed on his finger. And it was like, wow. Yeah. Okay, so what were we talking about? Rabbi. So just to be clear, Judaism's fragmentation, the beginnings of rabbinic Judaism. But then what happens in 70 AD? The Romans destroy the temple. No more temple, no more priests. Romans killed most of them. No more sacrifices. And what do we have left? Pharisees. The Pharisees go to the Romans and they say, we're not a threat to you, right? And the Romans say, well, you can't stay in Jerusalem. So they sent him to a city called Yavne, and that's where what we have now. I mean, what we have now in the world is rabbinic Judaism. That's an important distinction. Jesus is referred to as rabbi 13 times in the Gospels. Sometimes he'll question. Remember, I told you rabbi means good or great, and he'll say, "Why do you call me good? There's only one good." So every now and then, it's like he's a little irritated. Don't call me rabbi unless you understand what that means. And being a rabbinic individual, he quotes the Hebrew Bible extensively, and I won't give you all of the references, but he quotes the Old Testament 43 times. His favorite seems to be Psalms. He quotes Genesis twice. He quotes Exodus 5 times, Leviticus 3 times, Deuteronomy 7 times, Psalms 11 times. I won't go through the whole list. Let me give you a couple of examples of what in the rabbis call building a fence around the Torah. That's fundamentally what a rabbi does. So here's the Torah, here's a law, here's a commandment. And so to help you not break that commandment, I have the oral law, and I'm going to build fences around the law. And let me give you a couple of, interesting examples. I think I already gave you this one. In Deuteronomy, it says that you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. Deuteronomy 21, 1 through 4. But the rabbis have come up with this idea that you can't even hold a tool in your hand on the Sabbath because you might forget it's the Sabbath and work, and then you would be breaking the Sabbath. And I gave you the example, you can't spit on the Sabbath because the spit might run downhill. If it runs downhill, that makes mud, and making mud is work. And again, we roll our eyes and we think, how silly But if your salvation depends on getting this right, you better get it right. This was a new example for me. And the Ashkenazi, that's the German Jews, they won't eat rice for Passover. Now, nowhere is rice forbidden. But they're afraid that rice looks too much like other leavened foods like cornmeal or something made from wheat or barley or rye that has leaven in it. So they don't eat rice just because it looks like something they might not eat. Are you tracking with me here? Exodus 31:26 says to you don't boil a kid in its mother's milk. Apparently the pagans, the Canaanite religion did that, and God forbid it. And it's also obviously a very cruel thing to do. And so in Judaism, you don't eat meat and milk together. And if you go to an Orthodox kitchen, they'll have two kitchens. They have a milk kitchen and a meat kitchen, just so you don't mix them. But I'd never heard this before, but in Judaism, we have what are called hours of separation. And these hours of separation are between meals that contain meat or milk, so that they don't mix in my stomach. Yeah, interesting. Okay. My example is I drive 65 just so I don't go 70. Same kind of thing. Okay, but the thing is, as a rabbi, Jesus does this. He builds a fence around some of the commands to help us not break them. But the character of the way Jesus does it is completely different. It's not this burdensome thing. It has to do with your heart. He's always talking about your heart. So let me give you some examples of Jesus building a fence as a rabbi around the Torah. And I call this the difference between the old orthodoxy and the new reality. Jesus is introducing a new reality. And this comes to us from Matthew 5. And you know these passages. You have heard it was said. That's the formula he uses. You have heard it was said to the people long ago, do not murder. And anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. Okay? But I tell you, that's the second part of the structure, that anyone who's angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother, Raka, which means empty, is answerable to Sanhedrin. But anyone who says you fool will be in danger of hell fire. So there, you see what he just did? He said, it says you're not supposed to murder, but if you're not angry, you're not ever going to murder somebody, right? He's building a fence around the Torah, and yet it's still about the heart. It's not just an empty commandment. This is verse 27. You've heard it was said, do not commit adultery. But I tell you, see, there's the formula, that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. It's a heart issue. My note says he redefines sin using the imagination or the heart and not the act. It's the condition of the heart, and that's what the new reality is all about over the old orthodoxy. And verse 31 goes on doing it. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a bill of divorcement. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for marital unfaithfulness, causes her to commit adultery, and anyone who marries a woman so divorced commits adultery. And this has been turned into a prescriptive thing, and people who struggle with divorce, who through divorce, both my brother and sister have been divorced, they've kind of been beat up with this. I think what Jesus is basically doing is making a statement on what true marriage is. And in Matthew 19:6, he'll say that if God puts you together, man can't separate you. I think that's the principle. And so if God has put you together and you try to be separated by man, you remarry, then it's adultery because you've never been separated in the first place. You see what I'm saying? Marriage is something that God does, I think, in Jesus' mind. But the truth is, because of the hardness of our hearts, the provision has been made for divorce because God knows we have hard hearts. And so it's a heartbreaking thing. But again, I say the biblical provision is there, but God never intended it to be that way. And if you've suffered through a divorce, you understand that better than I do. Here's oaths. Again, you've heard it was said to the people of long ago, do not break your oath, but keep the oath that you've made to the Lord. That's Leviticus 19 also. But I tell you, don't swear at all, either by heaven or for it's God's throne, or by the earth for it's his footstool, or by Jerusalem for it's the city of the great king. Don't swear by your head. You can't make one hair black or white. Simply let your yes be yes and your no be no. And so in the new reality that we live in the kingdom, a casual word, a yes or a no, is just as serious and binding as an oath. Stanley Hauerwas says, oaths are a sign that we live in a world of lies. Couple more. You've heard it was said. And just sidebar, remember I said last night that Jesus will say the same thing over and over again? He repeats himself a lot. And that, again, that is not someone who's trying to be obscure. He's the last thing he is obscure. Okay. So you've heard it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if someone wants to sue you, take your tunic, let him have your coat as well. If someone forces you to go 1 mile, go 2 miles. And that's a reference to Roman impressment. The Julian Code allowed a Roman soldier to force you to carry any burden for 1 mile. And you see this when Simon is forced to carry the cross for Jesus. That Roman soldier can say, you pick that up and carry it, and you've got to do it for 1 mile. And Jesus says, well, if they make you do that, then carry it for 2 miles. And you see a little bit of his heart, and I think in a little bit of his attitude. But this is, again, this is the new reality. This is a new righteousness that he's introducing us to. But he does it as a rabbi building a fence around the old law. I think one more. Yeah. Let me do that. Verse 43. You've heard it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, and this is the most radical thing in the list, but I tell you, love your enemies. Because I just thought of this the other day. Well, what happens if your neighbor is your enemy? You're going to have to love them, right? But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven, and on it goes. So, and Jesus perfectly lives that out when he forgives the people that are crucifying him. Okay, so that's one example of Jesus building a fence around the law. The law says this, but I say this. And in one sense, if you obey the new law that he's given you, you won't get close to breaking the old law. Here's one other thing that Jesus did that I think is very rabbinic, and this has to do with what is called the pillars of piety in Judaism. There are four pillars of piety. You give to the poor. Let's see, what are they? You give to the poor. You pray. And you fast. There are three pillars of piety. Huh? Or there, maybe there's... Okay, I just think there's three. You give to the poor, you pray, and you fast. In Judaism, these are not optional. And if you're a Gentile convert to Judaism, you do these things. This is not optional. But Jesus, as a rabbi, sort of pronounces an innovation. He adds something to those pillars of piety. And let me read that passage to you. This is Matthew 6. And this is the context. Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness, that's the pillars of piety, before men to be seen by them. If you do, you'll have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, that's giving to the poor, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by men. I tell you the truth. That's amen. That's Jesus' odd use of the word amen. Amen. They have their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, and this is a unique statement of Jesus, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. That's the innovation, the rabbinic innovation that Jesus adds to the pillars of piety. You do these things, but you don't let anybody know you're doing them. That's what he added to the thing. then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you openly. So you still do it for a reward, but you do it for a reward from the Father. You know, you're still going to get an open reward, but it's going to be from God. So there's giving to the poor. Here's prayer. And see how he's repeating himself again? And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue. See, this context is the synagogue. And on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth. There's the structure again. Amen. They have received their reward in full. When you pray, go into your room. And this is an unusual Greek word that describes a room in the inner part of the house that has a door. Go into your secret room or storeroom. Close the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. Who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, don't keep babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need and before you ask them. And the final one is fasting. Verse 16. And when you fast, and he didn't say if you fast, when you fast. This is not optional. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces. And that word has to do with concealing. They conceal their faces to show men that they're fasting. I tell you the truth. See the structure? They have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face so that it will not be obvious, in contrast to being concealed. So it will not be obvious to men that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Okay? Let me talk a little bit about you. Does that make sense? Those are just two examples of Jesus sort of being a rabbi. He's building a fence around the law, and he's adding to the pillars of piety. Let's talk about Jesus in the synagogue quickly. Synagogue. Isn't it interesting? Rabbinic Judaism is based kind of on two things, rabbi and synagogue, and those words aren't in the Old Testament. And synagogue's a Greek word. How interesting. It just means gathering place, synagogue. There are 34 references to the synagogue in the Gospels. And once again, synagogues in Jesus' day are not like synagogues now. It's just an up-and-coming sort of form. There are different kinds of synagogues in Jesus' day. It's used as a meeting room. It's used as a guest house. So it will develop into the synagogues that we know today, but in Jesus' day, it's not quite what it developed into. There are five statements that summarize Jesus' work in the synagogue. He preaches four times in those statements. He's said to be preaching. Three times he's said to be teaching. Twice he's said to be healing. And once he's said to be casting out demons. And he's doing this in Galilee and in Judea. Eleven times, you can tell I'm reading from my lists. Your Bible nerd reading from his list. 11 times the word occurs in statements of Jesus. I think we just saw where he says, don't be like hypocrites who do these things in the synagogue. In Matthew 10, he says, they will flog you in their synagogues. Synagogue discipline is something that Paul brags about when he talks about he'd been received 30 or 40 stripes, save one. That's synagogue discipline. And Paul is very proud of this. That's not Roman flogging. That's synagogue discipline with rods. And he's very proud of that. And so Jesus said that's going to happen. They're going to flog you in their synagogues, synagogue disciplines. And in Matthew 23, he talks about synagogues. Hypocrites love the best seats in the synagogues. And in Luke 11, he says Pharisees love the best seats in the synagogues. In Luke 12, he says, when you're brought up before the synagogues, don't be anxious. Okay. And I've got a passage I'm going to look at here, but this is just some of my lists. There are five separate scenes of Jesus in the synagogue. The first one is in Mark 1 in Capernaum. On a Sabbath, he exorcises a demon, and there's no opposition. The second one is in Matthew 12. There's no reference to what city it is. You just sort of assume it's Capernaum. And it's on the Sabbath, and that's where he heals the man with the shriveled hand. And that's also seen in Mark 3. And the Pharisees begin the plot to kill him. In Mark 3, they're already plotting to kill him. The third reference is he's in Nazareth. It's the Sabbath. We're going to look at this passage. He reads from the scroll of Isaiah. Initially, the people are amazed, but then they become enraged, and they try to throw him off a cliff. I've been to that cliff. The fourth one is in Capernaum. There's no reference to the Sabbath, and that's where he teaches on the bread of life. And I call it improper synagogue talk. That's where he talks about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. You don't say that stuff like that in a synagogue. And the fifth one, there's no reference to it being Sabbath, but he's teaching and he heals a woman with a bent spine. The synagogue leader is indignant. His adversaries are humiliated, but the crowd rejoices. Okay, so let's look at just a couple of these passages. Let's look at the rejection in Nazareth. Yeah, I'm out of time already, aren't I? Okay. Yeah, because one of these is like one of my favorite passages of all time. Okay, this is Luke 4. When the devil had finished all these temptations, he left him until an opportune time. So you're not going to leave him. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. This is solo synagogue ministry before he has disciples. He went to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. So he's an observant Jew, and on Shabbat you go to synagogue. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me. Therefore, he's anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And that's Jubilee. That's a reference to the Jubilee year, which is celebrated every 50 years. And it involves cancellation of debt, freedom from slavery, and a vacation or a rest for a year. You even let the ground rest for a year. And the sad truth about Jubilee is we have no reference in any Jewish literature that the Jews ever celebrated it. God says here, I'm going to give you a year off. I'm going to cancel your debt. And if you're a slave, I'm going to set you free. And it doesn't get any better than that. I mean, what if I came to you and said, okay, next year, your mortgage is going to go away, and you don't have to work. And you go, I'd rather just keep making my payments and go to work every day. You know, no thank you. So then he rolled the scroll back up. He rolled the scroll back up, gave it to the attendant, and sat down. Now, in Judaism, that means you're about to teach, because teachers sit down to teach. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. So they're waiting for a sermon. Oh, this is going to be good. This is the guy from Nazareth. This is going to be awesome. And here's the sermon. Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. You know, the little old ladies are taking notes. There. And that was it. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They ask in Mark 6. Parallel passages, they say, isn't this the carpenter? So initial acceptance, it was going so well. And Jesus said to them, surely you'll quote this proverb to me. This is only in Luke. Physician, Luke's a physician. Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what we've heard you did in Capernaum. I tell you the truth. And once again, we'll talk about this later if you want to. This is an odd thing that Jesus does. NIV translates it, I tell you the truth, but it's just the word amen. It comes from the Hebrew word emet, which means truth. So King James translates it truly. The thing is, nobody knows how to translate it. I tell you the truth, verily, verily, truly, truly. But we know what you do with amen. You put amen at the end of things, right? We pray, and then everyone says amen. That's how you use amen. Jesus doesn't use amen that way. Jesus says it at the front of things. And as best as I can describe it, it's his way of waving a red flag and saying, I'm about to say something very important. So truly, truly is actually a pretty good translation. But no one in the world in all history ever used the word amen the way Jesus used it. Pretty interesting. So amen. And he uses it once in the synoptics and twice in John. So if you hear truly, truly, you know that's from John, because he says it twice. So I tell you the truth, he continued, no prophet is accepted in his own town. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, this is 1 Kings 17, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years, there was a severe famine throughout the land, yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. So what is he basically saying? Jesus' standard synagogue sermon is that God reaches out to Gentiles before he reaches out to Jews. Not a good synagogue sermon, right? Not a good choice for a synagogue sermon. So, and now he's going to give you another example, as if one example is not bad enough. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. Oh, gosh. Gentile. God reaches out to Gentiles before he reaches out to Jews. And here's what happens. The people who, in verse 22, were amazed. Verse 28, all the people in the synagogue were furious. And I think that's the Greek word anoia. They were annoyed. Okay? They were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill. Nazareth is on this long ridge, and the ridge drops off. And there's actually a military airport. Yeah, military base in the plane, so you can see the planes taking off. But they weren't there then. This is earlier. So the people are furious. They got up, they drove him out of the town, they took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked through the crowd, right through the crowd, and went on his way. And there's no reference of Jesus ever going back to Nazareth. This seems to be the last time he was ever there. So in Matthew 9, Capernaum becomes his home base. You have time for one more? Let's see. Yeah, let's do the really inappropriate synagogue talk. This is John 6. And if ever there's a passage that speaks of the scandal of the gospel in terms of its relation to Judaism, this is it. Now, I think I already told you this before. Jesus is parabolically connects his identity to the things he does in John. He'll open the eyes of a man born blind, and then he'll say he's the light of the world. In this passage, he talks about the fact that he's the bread of life. Well, this is in the context of the fact he just fed 5,000 people. So he sort of validates what he says about himself by the miracles that he does. Okay, so that's the context. This is John 6:25. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? And he doesn't answer their question. He never does. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. There it is. You're looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. He had just fed them on the other side of the lake. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, God the Father has placed his seal of approval. And that's a reference when you have a loaf of bread that it has to be inspected to make sure it's clean, and it's sealed. So it's kind of an ominous thing when Jesus says that God has placed his seal of approval on him, because what it means is that Jesus is fit to be sacrificed. That's what that means. Then they ask him, what must we do to do the works of God? Sounds like the same question the rich young ruler asked in Luke 18. Jesus answered, the work of God is to believe. To believe in the one he sent. So they ask him, what miraculous sign will you do that we may see it and believe in you? What will you do? Our forefathers ate the manna, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Hint, hint, hint. You see what they just did? See, Jesus says, you're just here because you want to be fed again. So then the conversation changes and they go back to, our forefathers ate manna. Hint, hint, hint. They want more bread. You know about the word manna? It's the most interesting word there is. It's untranslatable in the first place. I love untranslatable words. I can literally translate it for you. Ma is a question mark. My name is a Hebrew name, Michael. The M in my name is a question mark. My name means who is like God. I was so disappointed. I thought it was a statement. I thought, how insightful of my mother to have named me that. But it's not a statement. My name's a question. Michael is who's like God, and what's the answer? No one's like God. Boy, was I disappointed when I found that out. But the M in my name is a question mark. So mana, the ma is a question mark. Na is an exclamation point. Maranatha, okay? That's an exclamation point. Hosanna, okay? That's an exclamation point. So a literal translation of the Hebrew word mana is question mark, exclamation point. But no one has the guts to translate it that way. When I worked on the CSB translation, I begged them. I said, come on, let's go for this. This will be awesome. They wouldn't do it. So, but that's what mana is. It's untranslatable. It's because they held this bread and mana. What, please? You know, we don't know how to translate it. And so Jesus says, he's the manna. So our forefathers ate the manna, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. And that's in a targum. That's not in the Bible. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. There it is. It's not Moses who's given you bread from heaven, but it's my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They have no idea what he's talking about. Sir, they said, from now on, give us this bread. Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you've seen me and you still don't believe. All that the Father gives me will come, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. It's very important that he says that because he apparently is going to drive a bunch of people away here in just a minute, so hold on. But whoever gives to me, God gives to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven like the manna, not to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. And that's Jesus' favorite circumlocution for God. We talked about that in John. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he's given me, but raise them up at the last day. And this is a passage where you see Jesus' mind work, because he gets this idea of raising us up on the last day, and he repeats it at least four times, or three or four times. This is the first one. But I will raise them up on the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I shall raise him up at the last day. Hear that? Hear the... And I read things like that, and I think, oh, that's how his mind works. I don't want to say he gets stuck on things, but he turns things over in his mind like that. At this, the Jews began to murmur, and that word for murmur is the same word that's used in the Greek Old Testament, the Septuagint, for the children of Israel murmuring in the wilderness. So this is a very Old Testament-y picture. At this, the Jews began to murmur against him because he said, I'm the bread that came down from heaven. And what I'd like to tell them is, it's about to get really worse. You know, if you think that's bad, just give him a minute because it's going to get much worse. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? Interesting to me that this happens in Capernaum, and they know about Joseph in Capernaum. Now, I'd expect that in Nazareth, so I wonder... If maybe, you know, we all, the theory is that Joseph dies, you know, he was old and he died early on. Maybe Joseph is still alive and he's living with him in Capernaum. I don't know. But is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he say, I came down from heaven? Stop murmuring, same word, among yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up again at the last day. There it is, like the third time. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, it's the call of God that makes everything possible. I love that. It's the call of God that makes everything possible. So no one can come to the Father, to me, unless the Father who sent me calls him or draws him. It's written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. No one who has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. I tell you the truth. He who believes has everlasting life. I'm the bread of life. Your forefathers ate manna in the desert, yet they died. But here's bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If a man, he's slowly getting to the point. If a man eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply amongst themselves. He's like, just threw gas on the fire. They don't even eat pork. I mean, this is kosher at Judaism. They began to argue sharply amongst themselves. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? And I wonder if there were people who got physically sick in the crowd when he started talking like this. This is radical. We've read this in Sunday school our whole lives, right? Hear this as if you're hearing it for the first time in the context that it's being spoken in. He's, for goodness sake, he's saying this in the synagogue. You know, this is powerful stuff. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. There it is again. That's the amen. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood. I mean, how much worse can he make it? Can he make it? You have no life in you. But these are important spiritual truths. If you don't get this, you don't get Jesus, right? Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up again at the last day. That's important to him, the fact that someday he's going to raise us up on the last day. Okay, it would have been good to stop right there, but he makes it even worse. For my flesh is real food. The disciples are thinking, please just say that you're speaking metaphorically. Please explain this away. And so he says, for my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. My note says, why do I feel so starved sometimes? It's because I'm not feeding on the living bread. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Our forefathers ate manna and died. That's the third time he said that. But he who feeds on this bread will live forever. And here's the kicker. He said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. So I call that inappropriate synagogue talk from Jesus. And that we'll close right there. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to be open and sensitive and hear your voice and hear these words as if we're hearing them for the first time. And we ask that your Holy Spirit would allow that to happen in all of us. We want to hear your voice. We want to see the what's swirling around you in these incidences in the gospel. So that also that we could know you better and follow you more closely and be better servants and love you more. Thank you so much for all that you've done for us and all that you continue to do for us. Thank you that you're the living bread and that we feed on you and that we know life only through you. And right now, at this moment, there's nothing but thanksgivings in our hearts for all that you are to us. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen.